and my own project, you are in the right room.
Thanks a lot. It's great to be here. It's a bit like a homecoming for me because I'm an open source and free software guy for over 20 years. I will talk a little bit about my story here in this talk. This is a bit of an unusual talk. I give a lot of presentation, but most of the time about like Nextcloud as a software and as a project. But this is a bit of a meta talk where I talk a little bit about my story and the history behind it, and also this maybe a bit unusual story with the fork from OwnCloud to Nextcloud. So I'm a computer scientist, studied in Germany, worked in all kinds of projects and companies, and doing open source and free software for over 20 years. Contributed like for over 20 years in different projects, mainly in the beginning in the KDE project. We'll talk about this in a second a bit. But I'm probably invited here as the founder of OwnCloud and the founder of Nextcloud, which is the successor and also the main topic of this talk. So a little bit of about the history, my personal history and the history of the project. So I got involved in KDE in the late 90s. So I remember it was like 96 or 97 when a friend of mine showed me KDE 1.0 beta something, so one of the very first versions. And I looked at it and I was like, wow, this is completely free software. This is done by a community, a worldwide community of volunteers, not by a company. And it looks very, very similar and as useful as Windows 95. So obviously this will be the future, right? I mean, this is as good as this evil commercial product, but it's done by volunteers and a community. So obviously this is the future. Sure, it needs a little bit of polishing here and there, but I'm really sure that the year of the Linux desktop happens like very soon, right? I mean, so this is really obviously the future. So I was really impressed by that and got involved in KDE quickly and did all kinds of things. Did development and build a fixing here and there and artwork and event organization and online stuff, and was a board member for some time and all kinds of other things. And I was really impressed by KDE because it is a real community project. There's no company behind it. It's really driven by volunteers. It's of course 100% free software, and was really impressed me. One of the problems, and also one of the problems why I think we never achieved like this year of the Linux desktop, is that we had a lot of rotating team members. So a lot of students contributed to KDE, and then at some point, I don't know, started a real job and started a family and did other things and then dropped out of the project, and then new people joined. But new people are new people. They need to like understand the software and the processes and so on. And they got involved and then dropped out again. So I thought that for something really sustainable, you need like a way that people keep on working like full time on the software to really compete with Microsoft and Apple and the others here. So my dream was always, can we find a way to really hire people to write free software? So this was always something I was wondering if it's possible. A little bit later, in January 2010, I announced the OwnCloud project as part of KDE at the time still. So the idea was that I saw a lot of people using Linux desktops, KDE desktops, and so on, but they are using proprietary cloud services. Right? They're using like Gmail for their email and Dropbox for files and other things. And I was wondering, okay, where exactly is the freedom if you use free software on your laptop, but all you're doing is starting a browser and using proprietary cloud services? So for me, it was clear that we need to have a free software alternative to that. And this is what I wanted to build with OwnCloud. I picked the HGPL license. This was a natural pick for me, because obviously this is something, the right license for server-side free software. The development really started. I released the version 1.0 written by myself. I mean, nowadays there's no code for me left, which is a good thing. But I started this and the community were growing and a lot of people got excited and we did developer meetups and the press wrote about it and so on. It's really growing. And I was wondering, okay, maybe there's a real opportunity here and maybe we can find a way to actually pay people to have something sustainable to push this idea forward and to have a real competitor to the big evil cloud services. And then in the end of 2011, I got in contact with two other people and we discussed, okay, maybe we can found a company around this. Maybe we can found a company to which is really able to hire people to write free software. So this was the idea. So we actually sat together and we decided, okay, let's do this. So one was the CEO, the other was took over sales and marketing, and I was the CTO. So we did this. And we founded this company in 2011, end of 2011. It was actually based here in Boston. The people convinced me to directly take venture capital from day one, because I was told that this is how you do a real company, and this is how it has to be. So I don't know if you're familiar with the way venture capital works, but this is then obviously we took a path of like growing fast, and if it's no longer growing, then shutting it down and do something new. So really, really fast, aggressive growth. Win fast, fail fast. But if you then get this company, this money, then you have to spend the money. You have to hire people and you have to build everything up. So we were forced to hire a lot of people that are unfamiliar with free software and open source. So some friend from me, from the KDE times, asked me, okay, Frank, do you know what you're doing here? Do you think this is a good idea? At the time, I thought that, yes, it is a good idea. Now I know better. But this is what happened. Of course, as you can already hear from what I said, there were some issues. So first of all, there was bad alignment between the management and the investors and the community, because we are a very active contributor community. Then there is, of course, the conflict between something sustainable. I mean, I believe that free software is all about sustainability. You're building something which still exists, like in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, right? That's one of the main ideas. But if you have venture capital world, you already care about like the next quarter and then the big exit, right? This is the whole game. So there was a conflict there. A lot of different ideas how to run these things, and this led to a lot of unhappy contributors, community contributors, and several key contributors left the project, and this is wasn't really working out. And there were some lots of other mistakes that I don't want to go into details here, some mismanagement. So this was not really working. Let's talk a little bit about the business model that was chosen at the time. First of all, dual licensing. So this means that OwnCloud was available under the HGPL license, which of course means that if you change the software, you have to release it again under the same license, right? That's what the HGPL says. But if a company doesn't want to do that, then OwnCloud said, yeah, no problem, just pay us some money, and then you get the software under this different license where you don't have to release your changes, and this costs money. So there was this dual licensing business model. The other thing was Open Core and Enterprise Edition, which means the Community Edition. One version of OwnCloud had only limited features, and then there was this other version which has all the features, but is completely proprietary. And this, of course, also didn't make the customers very happy, because they really wanted to use some open source here. But the company then said, okay, just use the enterprise version, you have to pay for it, and you have the normal proprietary software with all the problems, with vendor lock-in and all the stuff. To achieve that, we had to introduce a contributor license agreement, which means that every contributor has to basically transfer the ownership of their code, of their contribution to the company, because only then the company can do this licensing stuff here. And this, of course, created a conflict between the community interest and the company interest. I personally believe that open core business model is inherently unstable, because there's always this conflict. What you really want, have a situation where both parts work together, but here you have a conflict between like open source and non-open source. Product management, where some issues, because a normal company really requires to own the roadmap and to control everything, what happens. And this, of course, doesn't work if you have volunteer contributors who do what they want. predictability, what comes in the next version. One of the examples was UnCloud was available in version 2.0, 3.0, 4.0, 4.5, 5.0, 6.0, and so on. You're wondering why there was a version 4.5? Well, the answer is easy, because one of the managers promised one of the investors that one specific feature is available in version 5. But it wasn't ready, so we had to rename the version to basically make the investors happy. So all this kind of stuff, it was really not a good thing. And then, of course, the company rejected community contributions because the feature was already in the enterprise version. So the community started to compete with the company. It's a really bad situation. Another thing is, of course, the interest of the investors, right? And the investors, they give you money for the company and to sell it later to make a big profit. But to make a big profit, the company has to be valuable. And for that, it's important that the company owns something. For example, the intellectual property, for example, the code. One of the reasons why there needs to be a contributor license agreement to basically transfer the ownership into the company so the company can be later in a big exit sold to someone else to make a lot of money. It's one of the other stupid things. Another thing was the market. I mean, the market where we were in was the enterprise file sync and share market as defined by Gartner. So Gartner defines these markets. And one of the most popular features was a calendar at the time. So OwnCloud had a very powerful calendar and the community really liked it. But the managers, basically, of the company were really confused because what do you mean calendar? That's groupware. That's a completely different market, right? We can't do both, right? So, I mean, I think you get the point. You really have these different mindsets and it really, really, really didn't work out. So what was the situation in 2015 and 2016? The community was not happy. The community volunteers left the project. The employees were not happy. Most of them were friends of mine. I brought them into the company, said, hey, come work for us. We're doing great free software here. But in reality, they had to do proprietary development. And of course, the customers were also not happy because they thought we're using open source here and free software. But in reality, of course, it was proprietary software that I had to buy, the enterprise edition. So I tried to fix that internally for a long time. I had countless meetings to try to convince people how this all works, how this can be done in a good way, but I failed. And of course, at the end of the day, because this business model was broken, there were also financial trouble. So if this would have been a proprietary software company, then it would have died. Right? Like lots of startups die all the time. It just didn't work. But the software was actually good. The idea was good. The community was good. The employees believed in the mission. The customers were happy. Only the overall structure of everything was broken. So because a big part of it was actually still free software, AGPL, there was the opportunity to fork this and to fix a lot of these mistakes. And this basically led to the next cloud fork. And this was really, I don't think I'm exaggerating, but one of the biggest decisions of my life and lots of my friends there. So in May 2016, 12 people, including me, left this broken company, OwnCloud, left their jobs. Of course, OwnCloud was already in a bad place in the first place and got bankrupt really, really, really soon after that. It's already broken. And we founded Nextcloud, the Nextcloud project, and we also founded a Nextcloud company because we still wanted to have something where we can work full time on to write free software. Something where we can still pay our bills by doing good thing. So we founded this new company and this new project as a reboot of the old idea, but to get rid of this broken structure, investors, management, and other things. So the first thing we did was we all locked ourselves into a house in Germany for a week, And we did a lot of brainstorming. So we discussed, okay, what was good, what was not so good, how should this new thing work, what are the goals, what is our business model, how do we really want to do that? So what is the what is the better way to run this kind of project and this kind of company? Obviously, the old idea was not so good, so how do we want to do this better? And we came up with some principles, some things that we really wanted to make better this time. The first is, this whole thing should be sustainable, and because of that, we don't want to have any external investment, because external investors always have expectations how to get their money back, and you have this like pressure of quarterly revenue and all kinds of other things, and we don't want to have this anymore. It should be sustainable, a company where we can all work on like in the next 10, 20, 30 years. The next is we really want to do everything free software. We don't like this open core thing, this dual licensing mess, and all this other stuff. It should be just a normal, sustainable, free software, open source project, because this is what we all believe in. Third is we don't want to have a contributor license agreement anymore. Right? We don't want to have these contracts. The company has no interest in owning any rights of contributions. It doesn't make any sense. You can see this in lots of other projects, the Linux kernel and KDE and GNOME and lots of other projects where basically you have shared ownership of the code. And this is fine. This is not a problem. Actually, it's a good thing because it's kind of insurance against like evil companies. Then we want to use open standards as much as possible, of course. We want to do everything federated and decentralized. So that's also the reason why as Nextcloud, we don't do any hosting. Sometimes people come to us and, hey, do you offer Nextcloud hosting? No, we don't do that. We only do the software, you do the hosting. It would be weird if we would basically build up like a centralized, official, main, whatever, hosting for our software. It's all about federation and decentralization. We want to have open community processes. We don't want to have any like closed door meetings and other secret roadmaps and stuff. We want to have everything in the open, because only then the community can actually contribute. And then we really want to have a diverse community which is inclusive, because I believe in, and everybody else believe in it too, that this is the mandatory thing for a healthy ecosystem and community. Okay, so this is all great. So we decided to do a lot of stuff in a good way, but how do we actually make money? And how do you actually pay people? Which is an interesting question, of course. So we really wanted to have a real HGPL business model. A business model which works with free software. No weird tricks and no whatever proprietary things. It's actually not that hard, because there are some examples how to do it. You can look at what Red Hat and SUSE, or nowadays MariaDB and a lot of other companies do, where the software is 100% free software, and it's actually shared ownership between it, but you can still make some money to pay for your people. You do this by focusing on big customers usually, and what we do is we sell them enterprise subscriptions. So these are subscriptions that come with support and help them with security and help them with scalability and do some branding and professional services, consulting projects and other things. And they are bundled together in the subscription, and this is what we sell. And this is something that usually big organizations and big companies need. Right? But this is nothing that everybody needs. Right? Nextcloud can be downloaded from our homepage and used by everybody, and it's used by millions of people, and this is all fine. You don't need a subscription. But if you run it in a mission-critical way in a big company, you sometimes need like SLAs and other things, and this is what we sell. And this is very similar, very, very similar to what Red Hat is doing, where you can run like Fedora or CentOS if you know what you're doing. That's all great. But if you want to have this like in a certified way and with SLAs and so on, you buy like RHEL, and then you get this. And this is how you make money, and this is exactly the same for us, and this is working. So where are we today, and where do we want to go? So I'm really, really happy to say that this is working. I mean, this was a big gamble, but it is working. So we have more community contributions than ever before. I looked at the statistics lately. I think we have over 1,900 code contributors at the moment, really only contributing code alone. Of course, there's a lot more. There are like translators and all kinds of other things where you can get involved, but close to 2,000 volunteer coders. As a company, we have 45 full-time employees, most of them developers writing free software. I'm a bit proud that we can pay for that. We are actually profitable, and we don't have any external investment. So if you do this in a fair way, you can. Free software is a great thing. It works for companies, and you can build a business around free software. You don't need to do this weird licensing tricks and common clause and proprietary whatever and enterprise editions and dual licensing and stuff. If you're really fair to everybody, if you communicate what you're doing, then this is working. We don't have a contributor agreement anymore. 100% of what we're doing is free software and open source. So the server is all AGPL. And different clients we have, they are GPL. So this whole forking, this really was faster than what I personally expected. So only 2 weeks after we announced the fork, we already had the first version out. It was faster than what I expected, but the community went crazy, and this was working. All pull requests have the same priority. So it doesn't matter if a feature or a bug fix or something is done by someone who works for the company or just a community volunteer, doesn't matter, it all has the same priority. We remove the community PR roadblocks that if you're not in the meeting, then you can't contribute. This is all gone. And we all even do crazy stuff that our main company website is on Git, and we got a lot of community contributions to our company website. This is a bit crazy, and a lot of classic companies probably think you can't do that. This is like weird, but at the moment we don't even have a web designer. Like the design of our website, I think it's actually very pretty, is done by a volunteer in the community. So if you're really open, then people appreciate it and they contribute. So this is a photo of our last conference in Berlin from last summer. We had over 200 people there. So over 200 people that spent their free time coming to this event to contribute to the software. So those are all contributors and not users. So I'm really happy that this is growing. Of course, some things are difficult, some things are challenging. One of the things that are tricky are trademark. So the term own cloud, I came up with the term own cloud. My wife did the logo and everything, but of course that I no longer own cloud, the trademark, right? This is why we had to came up with the term Nextcloud as a successor. And trademark is something that takes some time. So this is a chart from Google Trends. I don't know if you know Google Trends is a tool where you can track how often a term is searched and looked at on the internet. And the red line is like own cloud, and the blue line is next cloud. And I'm happy that we are overtaking the old project in popularity and in brand awareness. But of course, it takes a long time. You can talk to the LibreOffice and OpenOffice guys. They can tell you a lot of stories. How many people still download OpenOffice while think that this is an active project while it's not. So it actually takes a long time to overcome the old brand awareness, but we're getting there. As a company, we actually have a lot of big customers who pay us for AGPL software. It's weird, I know. Not for the software license itself, obviously, because we don't sell any licenses, but we sell like the subscription around it. And we have like the German government using us. There's the Red Cross. There is like University of Hawaii and a lot of others who actually buy a subscription from us. So this is working. We also launched an include project that's a diversity project last fall. I'm happy that I've won an innovation prize last fall, and this went into this project where we support underrepresented groups. We do offer mentoring and internships and travel support and other things, so we're trying to do something in this area too. And this is how we are as a project and as a company. Now I want to tell you a little bit what we actually do as Nextcloud, because I haven't really mentioned that at all. So what is actually Nextcloud? What is our mission? What are we doing? First of all, I have to say that we are a bit crazy and stupid, because we really, really try to compete with the big guys. So our mission is to provide an alternative to Microsoft, Dropbox, Google, iCloud, and all these other proprietary, centralized, evil cloud services. Right, so we want to be an alternative to those, of course, in a free software way, open source, and as I mentioned before, completely decentralized and federated. Right, so we want to basically fight against those evil proprietary data silos and make the internet federated and distributed and free again. So this is what we try to do. So this is like, if you log in, this is the web interface. You have a nice web interface. We have actually a very active designer team, usability team, who helps us to make something that's actually usable with normal people. It's like a file manager, and you can comment files and look at the versions and chat with around files and so on. A lot of people never use the web interface, because we are actually have very good clients. So on the left-hand side is an Android client, and there's an iOS client for mobile and direct integration into iOS, which makes it very usable for normal users. This is the desktop client, so we have a client for Mac, Windows, and Linux, written in C++ with Qt. So this is for synchronizing files between your laptop and your server, as you know from Dropbox and Google Drive and OneDrive and others. Very similar, we have same features, same usability, I think, but again, this is all GPL software, this is all talking to your server that you host yourself, where you know where your data is, which is also free software, and we can also talk to other servers, federated and distributed. Strong authentication with two-factor authentication, obviously, what we are doing is useless if it's not secure. Federation, I mentioned this a few times, this is a very important concept for us. This means that if you have a Nextcloud server here, this might be my Nextcloud server at home, this is a Nextcloud server at a university, a Nextcloud server at a service provider, Nextcloud server at a company, and we all have different users, but we can all talk to each other and we can all share files and communicate. Right? A lot of people nowadays think that social networking and sharing files requires to have a centralized data silo, a centralized company who owns everything. That's of course bullshit. Right? I mean, the whole internet was built as a federated, distributed infrastructure. And it's absolutely possible to do social networking in a distributed way, in a federated way, and the same for file sharing and communication and everything, right? There is no need that everybody's using WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger and everything is owned by one company. That's just a myth. A lot of younger people think that it has to be like that. No, it doesn't have to be. It only exists because of the business model of those companies. But you can do everything, the same user experience and the same functionality with free software and distributed. And this is what we try to do here. We support end-to-end encryption for sharing of files, very popular feature. We can actually scale to a lot of users, so something like Nextcloud can be deployed on a small Raspberry Pi at home for 2 users for your family, but it also works for a lot of users. So the biggest instance has 20 million users. So the biggest instance is a big service provider which has 20 million users, and Nextcloud is the same bits, by the way. It's exactly the same software which scales from very small Raspberry Pi to a big cluster over different data centers for millions of users. We have groupware functionality, calendar, contacts, email integration, as you know from other software. We have social networking components. We support the ActivityPub API, which means we can federate to Mastodon and GNU Social and other projects, because they all use the same API. And every Nextcloud server is a hub of those distributed network. So this is like a distributed Twitter here, compatible with all those other projects. There's chat functionality. So this is a group chat here, very similar to Slack or Microsoft Teams, where you have different rooms and you can talk to people. We even have iOS and Android applications where you can chat on your phone with other people. You get push notifications if someone mentions you. And of course, you can press a button and turn it all into video calls. So we have fully self-hosted, free software, peer-to-peer and encrypted video calling features, very similar to Skype and Google Hangouts and all these other evil proprietary centralized companies, but self-hosted, distributed using WebRTC, by the way, works on all modern browsers. And of course, we can also do crazy stuff like collaborative document editing with different people in the same document. We are working together with LibreOffice here, by the way, with different people, with different cursors in the same document, while you have a chat room on the side with the same people who are working on the same document and a video call with the people in the same document at the same time. So this is a feature which doesn't even Microsoft or Google has. So this is a really, really nice way where you can see that you can build like competitive, nice, useful tools for normal people in a decentralized way with free software. Okay, now I'm coming to the summary of my talk. So we are crazy enough that we really want to build a solution that replaces Office 365 and Google Suite and Dropbox and iCloud, but 100% self-hosted and 100% free software and without a vendor login. So I think this is something that we really need for the future. And it's a big task, yes. But I think it can be done. And by the way, it can only be done with free software. Because we are just a few people, right? It's just a few, me and a few friends of mine. And we are not crazy enough to think that we can really compete with Microsoft and Google here. But we can, because first of all, we're standing on the shoulders of giants, right? This free software movement, and you're all part of that. We did a lot of amazing innovation over the years, and we can build on top of that. That's the first reason, and the second is the community, right? It's not just like 40 people who are paid to do Nextcloud. We actually have like 1,900 volunteers writing code. And this doesn't even count the LibreOffice project that we're integrating and other things that we're integrating. So with free software, we are more than that. So we are this big community, and together we can actually compete with these proprietary centralized data silos. Okay, so if you're interested in Nextcloud, you can download it on the website. It's of course packaged for most Linux distributions. There are Docker containers, there are like virtual machines pre-configured if you want to use that. And you can get involved, like everything, every issue, every feature request, every discussion, everything is in the open. And if you have any opinions and you want to get involved, you can go to GitHub. Yes, we still use GitHub, I know, but at the moment, you can get there and you can get involved. Thanks a lot.
We're going to take about 10 minutes for a question and answer. We have a mic up here. If you don't want to make it down or can't make it down, just raise your hand. I can bring you a mic.
So thank you for that excellent presentation. It's always a lot of fun to see, you know, successful businesses, you know, incorporate a lot of these, you know, sometimes difficult freedoms, but, you know, I guess if you make it a goal, you can achieve a lot of really outstanding things. So my question is, yes, I know you said that you guys are crazy, you're trying to compete with Microsoft and Google and Apple, but there are actually a lot of spaces in which you can legitimately enter that they might have a harder time. And so one of the ideas that comes to mind is a lot of universities have, you know, high performance computing and large storage. And so I think what's kind of become popular, funded by the National Science Foundation in the US, is the Globus file system. Do you guys have any integration with that to make sort of academic workflows and sharing easier? something you thought about.
So with different storages, you mean? Yeah, Nextcloud can run on top of everything that's a POSIX file system, NFS shares and whatever. We can also use S3 compatible object storage and Swift compatible object storage. And most of those projects can do that, create integration to the Ceph and storage, for example. I'm not sure about the global file system thing. I'm not sure about the APIs, but I'm quite sure there is something, because people use it for everything they want, right? It's really, we have an active community. If you just Google a bit, Nextcloud compatible with whatever, so many people write connectors and whatever, so I'm sure there's something, but I'm not sure yet at the moment.
So you said at the beginning of your talk that you did this with no outside investors. So I'm really interested in hearing about this. I just recently started a business and it's based on AGPL licensed software. Mm-hmm. And there was some discussion between the partners about whether we get an outside investor. Mm. So I'm really interested in how you kind of structured it and how you started without an outside investor, and also basically what you mean by that. Is it just invested by you as employees, or?
Yes. So first of all, I want to say that I don't have a general problem with investors. Right? I mean, that's fine, that's totally valid. But it's very important that everybody understands what it means, and that you also talk to your community, if you have a community, that they understand what it means, because it has some implication. I talk to a lot of young startups and entrepreneurs, and lots of them, they see investors just as free money. But it's, of course, not the free money, because you have to pay something back, maybe later. But everybody has to understand this, and everybody's fine with it, it's totally okay. But in our case, it wasn't okay, because the community thought that this is just a normal free software project. But there is this dependency to this investors. Another thing, yes, to answer your question, it is owned by the employees, yes, so in a way the employees invested in that. Yeah. So these are the owners of the company, basically. We were a bit in a special situation because we basically took over this existing project, which already had customers that I already knew. And the day I announced Nextcloud, they directly came to me and said, hey, can we switch? So I understand that it's a bit of a special situation. I'm not sure about your startup. Obviously, you need to pay salaries on day one. I understand this. And this can be a challenge. For us, it worked out. But it is definitely not easy. Yeah. Also, I mean, Nextcloud is like a well-known project and company at the moment. And I'm happy with the business model, obviously. But this is all not easy, right? I mean, I have to fight every day for new customers, right? It's not automatic. It's not a money printing machine, right? I guess if you're Microsoft and you wrote the software once, and the only thing you have to do is to sell another license, which is virtual, right? Then it's a money printing machine, right? It's not so easy for us. But I think with the right setup, it works.
Thank you.
Yeah, I understand pretty well your points about contributor license agreements being problematic. I'm just curious, have you found any trade-offs where you actually suffered a bit from not having that option to relicense things? For example, like trying to use AGPL code in the iOS app or anything like that?
Yeah, of course. There are some drawbacks. The Apple App Store is an issue. So our iOS app is GPL license. It's not AGPL as a server. The iOS app is GPL. And there is I'm not an expert, but there's a one sentence thing you can add to the GPL, which makes it compatible with the Apple App Store. This is recommended by the FSF and by the FSFE. I have to look it up, to be honest. But there is a workaround for this stupid GPL incompatibility of the Apple App Store. And of course, there are other things. I mean, sometimes a company comes to us and says, hey, we like Nextcloud and can we have it, but we have this non-viral GPL policy, what can we do? Then the answer is nothing. That's what we are. If you don't like GPL, then go somewhere else. But it really doesn't happen that much. I mean, I'm sure it was an issue like 10, 15 years ago, but nowadays it's fine. I mean, everybody's using Linux and Android and other free software things. So I think nowadays it's totally accepted.
Thank you for the talk. So you mentioned that Nextcloud doesn't host their own servers, but like one advantage of Office 365 or Google Cloud is that small and medium businesses that doesn't want like that special stuff can just use their service and have those features. So why do you guys decided on only supporting big companies that can host their own servers? But so, in a sense, dropping out to letting medium and small business like on their own. Is there some? I guess what's the reasoning behind this?
I mean, the whole mission behind Nextcloud is to trying to create a decentralized, federated internet again. So this is why we don't do any hosting, but we believe that. Are we trying to help everybody else to create like a node in this distributed network? So you can, we work together with service providers. You can go to nextcloud.com/providers. They have over 100 service providers listed where you can get Nextcloud from, right? You can definitely get Nextcloud from a service provider, just not from us. I think it would be weird if we would write the software and also be a service provider. There are service providers. And there are lots of universities who use it, and you can use it. There are boxes, there are devices you can buy, which already comes shipped with Nextcloud, and there are lots of different ways to get Nextcloud. We just want to don't want to be a service provider.
Okay, I guess I just didn't know about the provider stuff. Yeah. Sorry about that.
Yeah, sure, thanks.
So you've discussed how you make a business supporting users of Nextcloud. Do you ever worry that if you make Nextcloud too easy to install and administer, that you'll have a harder time finding customers?
Yes, that's an excellent question. That's an excellent question. And I would love to talk about this for another hour. So this is a... maybe I use this opportunity with this audience to raise a challenge we have in front of us here. And this is a bit in this direction. And this is like the discussion we had yesterday at the talk about the Commons Clause thing. So just to say it clearly, I really think the Commons Clause thing is a bad thing. And this whole discussion with like trying to save open source by making it not open source, right? I really hate this. This is a really bad idea. But I have to say that there is a bit of a challenge with the Amazons and the cloud, Google Clouds and all those other cloud providers, because as I mentioned, the most successful, or you could say the only open source business model out there is to sell this enterprise subscription support. Right? So we help organizations to host Nextcloud itself, same way as Redis helped them to host Redis themselves, or like MongoDB helps companies to host it themselves, Red Hat to host RHEL itself, and so on. But with this new trend in IT, that everything becomes a service, right? This is a challenge. Because if you just like get like some compute service from Amazon, you don't need a RHEL subscription anymore. And right? If you just like some database service from Google Cloud and from Amazon, you don't need like need a MariaDB subscription anymore, because MariaDB is already like magically running for you. You don't have to care. There is definitely a danger that this cloud services kill like lots of open source businesses. So in a way, okay, now I'm really playing devil's advocate here, but I have to say a tiny bit, I understand the Redis guys and the MongoDB guys. We don't have this problem yet, but if Amazon would take Nextcloud and say, hey, Nextcloud is now available for every other Amazon customer for free, we don't have a business anymore. Right? So I think the solution is really bad to make it proprietary, to make it open core, to make it like Commons Clause. This is all evil, and that's really a bad thing. But there is a challenge for us with this. Everything moves to a service. That's a challenge, because then Amazon and Google make money, and the rest of the world not.
Thank you.
Great. Unfortunately, we're out of time for questions, but thank you for your talk.
Good, thanks.